Hey, it's great to have you here. I want to welcome you into my office on a beautiful evening in New England in the autumn. And my empty bookshelf. Karen and I are having all the floors done in our house, and including the office. We went from a really dark finish floors to very, very bright. We have sort of a French country manor, blah 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 home, and it was all very dark. And then we needed to have the floors redone. We lightened it all up, and so we had to move all of our shit out of the house into a pod, and literally our house is completely empty. And then now we have painters here for the next several weeks and all that crap. And so that's why our bookshelves are empty. However, that being said, so many people have the full bookshelves to claim how brilliant they are. Even after years of, decades of childhood and then college and then seminary and graduate school and all the books, and then my father, after he passed, or as he was aging and I acquired all of his theological collection, or he offered so much of it and I didn't take it, most of it. I guess for me, it's just like, I don't know, I don't have a lot of books. And Karen has tons of them. So normally these bookshelves would be full, but you're looking at empty bookshelves. And if the fullness of a person's bookshelves were an indicator of the fullness of their mind, then my empty bookshelves are in fact an appropriate indicator of the emptiness of my mind. So you are seeing the emptiness of my bookshelves, and I'm a complete fucking idiot, but not that's news to you. So here we are in my empty home. This morning, Karen and I took the dogs. We have three dogs, a Rhodesian Ridgeback and two Morkies. And we took them down to Rye, New York. And in Rye, there's a beach there that, for the summer months at least, is open to people for sun tanning and swimming in the Sound, the Long Island Sound, which is, for most intents and purposes, the ocean. But then in the winter months, it's all enclosed. It's a huge beach, but it's all enclosed. And then for the winter months, they just let people bring their dogs because no one's sun tanning during those months. So we took the dogs, and they were playing. Let's say there were 70 dogs there today. And it was fantastic. Dogs had a great time, and it was cool. And we saw an old friend of ours. And anyway, afterwards, we sat in the parking lot on a conference call or just a group conversation with my mother, because we had had a date planned to be with her. Because it's 11 a.m. East Coast time, but it was 10 a.m. Central time. My mother's in Minneapolis, and we had already planned that we would meet her for her morning devotions. I grew up in a home where my dad was clergy, and my mother was a longtime director of Christian education in many large Christian churches. And morning times of a Bible reading and a sort of a lesson from a little devotional book and prayer every single morning. As all five of my siblings know, every single morning we had morning devotions. And one of Karen's and my favorite things, excuse me, whenever we go back to Minneapolis, would be to have morning devotions with my parents. I mean, fuck, my dad died at the age of 92. And so in their 80s and 90s, it was a really remarkable and beautiful thing to have morning devotion with them, to sit there with them in their dining room and to be with them in what was for them their most sacred time of every day. And it's fucking beautiful. So Karen had recently had the idea, well, let's have morning devotions with your mom. So today we did it again. And but we happened to be in this parking lot at the beach of Playland in Rye, New York, right from the beach, and our dogs were in the back seat. And mom led, and the text she was reading was something sort of, it was John the Baptist, Christian, and so forth. Now, those of you who know me know well enough that I don't, even though I am a former pastor, Christian Lutheran pastor, I don't go into Christian scripture and texts very often. But The text that Mom read, it was on John the Baptist, who was known as the precursor. From Latin, we know pre means before, cursor, one who runs. So it's the one who ran before. He was known as the precursor, the one who runs before. What did he run before? He ran before Jesus. He was the one that came before. And that got me thinking about a sermon I'd preached probably, I don't know, 15, 20 years ago. 12 years ago, whatever the hell it was. And it was a John the Baptist text. It really got me thinking about it today. And it relates not just to people who are Christians. The meta theme, the macro theme, not just the micro, which was a very Christian message, but the macro theme, which was a very applicable theme, even to an atheist, even to an agnostic, even to a Buddhist, even to a just a regular person who isn't really a, you know, faith person. But there's a spiritual theme to this text, and it's just been with me all day. And even after a gin and tonic or two, skull. I found myself sort of chewing on it. And the text is from Matthew 11. And there's a corresponding text in Luke, I think. Yeah, Luke. And the story is this. So John the Baptist, for those of you who don't know, was the voice proclaiming that the Savior is about to come. All right. And the Savior, of course, was Jesus in the myth system of the Christian church. Now, whether you buy that myth system or not, isn't really the point. There are some of you who follow me who are Christians, some who aren't, some who are atheists, some who are agnostics, some who are but all are very, very spiritual. And this particular story is that it's twofold. One, John the Baptist baptized Jesus. John was the baptizer. He was the one that basically dunked people in the water and says, you are now reborn into a life with intimate relationship with God. And he had baptized Jesus, okay? And one of the things we know from Christian scripture, whether you believe it is factual or not, isn't the point. If you want to think of this as metaphor, think of it as metaphor. If you believe it's factual, think of it as factual. The point is still the same, so stay with me here. So John the Baptist baptizes Jesus in the River Jordan. He dunks him in the water. And what happens is the heavens open up, as the story goes, and God says, it's my son in whom I am well pleased. And the dove descends, which was in the symbolism, if you believe it's just symbolic or actuality, it was the Holy Spirit. This event in all of Christian scripture is the only time that we have the presence of God the Father, God the Spirit, and God the Son all at one time. It is literally the only story in all of Christian scripture where all three heads of the Trinity are present. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They're all present. So John's fucking taking Jesus' fucking head and his long hair or whatever, right? Long hair, because that's what all the pictures say. And he was white and had blue eyes too. Anyway, he dunks Jesus' fucking head in the water and the heavens open up. The dove comes down, Holy Spirit, and God says, this is my son in whom I am well pleased. So in that moment, John the Baptist encounters the Trinity, Jesus, Spirit, Father, all at one time. Now, I don't know about you, but about me, if that were in fact literally motherfucking true, yeah, my fucking head would explode, all right? All right? If God and all his or her forms were present, yeah, it's kind of big shit, all right? But here's the thing. The text in Matthew 11 is about a month and a half later. Now John's in prison. John is in prison because John was a loudmouth fucking asshole, right? He was a loudmouth and he was preaching his fucking message. You know, he's like Black Lives Matter of today. He said they're loud and they got a message and they believe in it and they're putting it out there, right? And the authorities don't fucking like it, so they threw John in jail. And he's in jail. disciples, his followers, John's like ardent followers, come to him and say, hey man, what do you want us to do? And John says, hey, come here. I want you to go to Jesus and I want you to ask him this question. I want you to ask him, dude, are you like truly, truly the motherfucking Messiah? Are you truly the Savior? I'm in jail. I need to fucking know. All right. So his disciples, they run to Jesus, okay, as the story goes in Matthew 11. And they go to Jesus and they say, hey, man, John wants to know, like, what's the scoop? You know, are you really the fucking Savior? Because you mind you, these people have been waiting for hundreds, nay, thousand years for the Savior. The one that was going to save the Jewish people from their fucking misery of a very long time. To return them to the golden days of David, King David, or even greater. All right? Anyway. And so his disciples go and say, Jesus, are you the one? Are you the one? Are you the one? And Jesus says, go back and tell John everything you've seen that I've been doing. I've been making blind people see, deaf people hear, lame people walk. I've been like changing people's fucking lives. Go back and tell them all the shit I've been doing, man. Yeah, man, I'm the fucking one. All right? And they go back and they tell them and blah, blah, blah. And you know what's fascinating about that story to me that I've been thinking about all day since Karen and I had morning devotions with my mom on the different John the Baptist test. I was remembering that text. What's most fascinating to me is something very different than the point of the story. The point of that story is this conversation between John the Baptist and Jesus, who, by the way, were cousins. I found myself thinking about years ago when I first had to preach on this text, decades ago, actually, and then another time about 15 years ago when it really fucking hit me. But I was thinking about it again today, even as a, you know, person who questions everything and all that. John the Baptist sent his disciples to ask Jesus if he was the real thing. Implicit in his doing so was the notion, I'm not sure. Why would John the Baptist have sent his disciples if he absolutely knew and believed that Jesus was the Son of God, or in Trinitarian beliefs that he was in fact God himself? Why would he have sent them if he knew? If he knew, he wouldn't have sent his own disciples. So the fact that he sends his disciples to ask Jesus says, I don't know, right? Yeah, the fucking irony of that is literally a month and a half ago, John is in the fucking River Jordan baptizing Jesus by the fucking cranium, chucking him in the water, and God the Son, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit are all fucking there. So John has the benefit of seeing all three faces of the Trinity. John got to see God the, hear God the Father, see God the Spirit, and hold God the Son all at one time in this brilliant, like, fucking Thursday afternoon or Saturday or Tuesday evening or whatever the hell it was. He got all of that. And a month later, he's saying, hey, are you really the Savior? Are you really the Savior? Because I got God the Father, God the Spirit, and God the Son. But that's not enough for me. I still don't really fucking believe because this is so fucking stupid or crazy or whatever to me. I need more confirmation. Right? I mean, that's the story. Go back, read your fucking Bible or Google it or, you know, whatever you do. John the Baptist, who in all of Christian scripture is known as the most ardent follower of, believer in, espouser of Jesus. I mean, John the Baptist and the Apostle Paul, to two of them. Is there anyone in all of Christian scripture who, well, Stephen the martyr would be another one. So John Betts is one of the, if he isn't the top, he's one of the top fucking three proclaimers of Jesus and the message of Jesus and so forth. And whether you believe Jesus was dead for 3 days and came back to life, set that aside for the moment, all right? But in this story, you know, Jesus is, he's in this myth system, in this story, in the Christian belief system, he's the fucking killer. He's the badass. He is the man. He is the Son of God. And John doesn't believe it. John doesn't believe it after hearing from God, seeing the Spirit, and holding the Son. Okay. And you doubt it? So often as Christians, I remember as a pastor myself and as a Christian, as a kid or in my 20s or whatever, I had so many doubts. And you feel guilty over those doubts. You think you're not supposed to doubt. But here is the single greatest believer and single most integral person in the Jesus story doubting literally a fucking month after he heard from God, saw the Spirit, and held the Son. And he doesn't fucking believe it. And you feel bad over you're not believing it? This story is so fucking beautiful because it gives us all permission to disbelieve, to doubt, to question. It is the story that gives us permission to be human. It is the story that says it's okay. It's the story that says, oh, contrary to what we're all taught, oh, doubt is bad and disbelieving is bad. It's the story that says, no, man, this is really fucking real. His biggest fucking, his precursor, pre means before, cursor to run. The one who runs before Jesus, the one who set Jesus up, who prepared the way of the Lord, of Jesus, even he didn't fully fucking believe, even though it was a month after meeting God, Spirit, and Son. In other words, your doubts are petty. Your disbelief is small. Your questioning is nothing you should be ashamed of. It's okay. And for those of us who aren't Christian and like in the whole belief system, the point is not, do you believe in God and Jesus and all that? The point is this notion of spirituality. Is it real? Does Spirit exist? Does spiritual energy exist? Is it real? Are there things happening that science can't explain? Well, you know, it's kind of interesting in that regard. And I'm a huge believer in science. I was a mathematics major at an engineering university. I'm a huge believer in science. But the simple fact that there are trillions of dollars spent every year in a multitude of fields of science on research says that science has more questions than answers. They don't have all the answers. Why would you be researching if you had all the answers? No, you have questions. And I believe in science. I 200%. All right. But there are things inexplicable. There are things that science can't explain. There are energies and forces and things about life that are spiritual, that are owned by my people, and my people not just being the Swedes, Swedish Americans, but the people of spirituality. Questions we've been wrestling with for thousands of years. And one of them is there a spiritual energy, a spiritual force in the world? And in this case, even if you think of John the Baptist not as literally John the Baptist and Christianity and Jesus and dying and coming back to get to life 3 days later and so forth, what we're really wrestling with is this notion of spiritual energy, this notion of spirituality. Does it exist? Even though, like John the Baptist, you have had evidence in your life of spiritual things happening, and yet you still doubt whether it'll happen in the future. Even though you have evidence in your life of God acting and moving, or the universe, or the gods, or whatever you call it, even though you have evidence, even as recently as a month ago, or a month and a half ago, like John the Baptist, or 3 years ago, or 6 years ago, even though you have evidence in your life of things happening that you can't motherfucking explain, you still doubt. And not only do you feel guilt for that doubt, but more importantly, you doubt that it'll happen again. And that's what John the Baptist was asking. It's like, are you really a savior? Are you really going to follow through on your shit? And so as people living a spiritual life, we ask ourselves, can I count on spiritual things happening? And it's very real, it's very normal, it's very human to ask that question. And I guess my point in all of this is to say, whether you believe it or not doesn't mean shit. Whether you believe that spiritual shit actually fucking happens, that there are forces and powers that you don't fucking know about and you can't control, that you can't explain, whether you believe it or not, in a way it doesn't even fucking matter. You wanna know why? Because it's like fucking gravity. They're there and they exist and they're happening. And there are so many aspects of that spiritual life. There's so many aspects to the gods or God or universe or soul or however you wanna, whatever words you wanna use to characterize it. There are things happening in this world that you can't fucking explain and you sure as shit can't fucking deny. And you doubt them at times, but the point is they are there. And one of them, as I tell my clients all the time, and as I used to preach, that is the more you have the courage to be, say, do, and become. Be, say, do, become. On the outside of you, who you really are on the inside of you. The more you have the courage to manifest out here who you are inside, three things happen. One, you begin to lose people. You begin to lose people that you thought would be with you forever. Maybe it's a brother, a parent, a friend, best friend. People who are married to the idea of who you always used to be. And now you're becoming, on the outside, this different person, which is reflective of who you really are. You're beginning to live authentically. You're beginning to be, say, do, and become who you really are on the outside, reflective of who you are on the inside. And you start to lose people. And that's what causes us to shy away from becoming on the outside who we really are. Because we're terrified of losing people. And so we live a life that is different on the outside from who we really are. And that's that dissonance, that grating between what has been shoved down our fucking throat by society or parents or friends or whatever, who we should be, and then rising up from our soul, who we really are. And that's that grating, that shifting of the tectonic plates below the surface that causes earthquakes in our everyday life. We begin to lose people. The more we have the courage to become authentic and be who we really are, we start to lose people. And what's interesting is we knew in advance that we would lose them. We knew in advance that if I change, if I become someone new, I know I'm going to lose these people or this person because I know exactly what they'll fucking say. It's not the fear of the known, unknown, it's the fear of the known, that I know how people would respond if I changed. So the first thing is we're going to lose people. But the interesting thing The more we have the courage to live spiritually, the more we have the courage to become that which feels right in our soul and begin to live it out here, we begin to attract people effortlessly. And that's the key word, effortlessly. We begin to attract people who are drawn to that which we are becoming, who say, I fucking love who you're becoming, man. Or who say, you know what? If you went back to being who you used to be, I wouldn't be the least bit motherfucking interested. That doesn't interest me. I love what you're like growing into. Or who say, you know what? I love that you don't even know who you're becoming. I just love that you have the courage to become, to change, to grow. We begin to effortlessly attract people who are drawn to our new energy, our new growth, our new sense of self. That's the second thing. And then the third thing, and I can't explain it. I really have no idea why it happens, how it happens, whatever. I just know it's a fucking fact. I've seen it in my own life, and I've seen it in 30 fucking years of counseling people. Shit starts to fall out of the sky. That's the third thing. Shit that you didn't foresee, and by shit, I mean good shit, that you didn't foresee, that you in areas you weren't even expecting, amazing stuff starts falling out of the sky. And this isn't just Pollyanna bullshit. This isn't made up law of attraction, blah, blah, blah bullshit. This is just fucking fact. The more you have the courage to become who you really are in your soul and manifest that out here, the more shit starts to fall out of the sky. Fact, 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 fact. And so that's the point. That's the point in this story, is you can doubt spirituality. There's nothing wrong with doubting it because it's not factual. We can't taste it. We can't touch it. We can't feel it, but it's there. And this is something I have witnessed and I've chronicled in my own journals and worked with clients over the last 30 years. And that is, dopey as this sounds, and again, you're coming from a guy who has no books, so clearly I'm a fucking idiot. The spiritual life is real. It really is. And these are the patterns that I've seen over 30 years of doing this shit and over having parents who are 92. Father passed away, but my mother's 92. It's the same shit. All of their work, all of my work dovetails into this thing that if you have the courage to become who you really are, the craziest, most upside down spiritual shit starts to happen that you can't fucking predict in advance. You can't fucking foresee. And it's powerful and it's life changing. We begin to lose people. We begin to effortlessly attract people who love who we're becoming. And shit starts to fall out of the sky. Shit you hadn't even thought of before. And so the challenge to you is, do you have the courage to believe? Because you have evidence in your past of spiritual shit. You do. But you have so much fucking doubt, and there's nothing wrong with the doubt. That's okay. And in fact, that's a very reasonable position. But you have the courage to move forward, trusting in the spirituality of life. And this predates science. Mind you, science came along. Let's give science 2,000 years. They have been around since Jesus died, or 1,000 years. But spirituality has been around for thousands of years. So spirituality and fucking psychology, which has been around for what, 120, 140 years, right? They've co-opted a lot of our shit. And I'm a big believer in science and psychology and all that, but come on, this is our fucking realm. You can doubt this shit all you want, but there are truisms, there are maxims, there are patterns. There are patterns. And I've spent my life studying that shit. And the truth is, it can be counted on. We so depend on logic and that which is tangible because I can touch it and I can feel it. And it's like, if I can't touch it and feel it, I just can't believe it. I can't bank my life on it. And what I'm telling you is, now you can. I've seen it. I've seen it for 30 years and in so many lives, not the least of which is my own. That the more you have the courage to trust that inner voice and act on it and become who you really are, to manifest on the outside, to be, say, do, and become who you really are, everything fucking changes. And I know that sounds all fucking new age, namaste, kumbaya, fucking bullshit. Yeah? But it's fucking true, and I fucking challenge anyone to come at me with a better fucking theory. I've seen this shit in my own life and in the lives of others. And it takes great courage to become your truest self. But once you begin the process and once you fight through the fears rather than running from the fears, once you press into and through the pain rather than running from the pain, everything fucking changes. So that's the message for today, that it's easy to doubt, as with John the Baptist. Despite the evidence in your past, it's easy to doubt that there's any significance, weight, truth to the spiritual life, but you've seen evidence in your past, yet you're terrified of believing in it fully. And the doubt is okay. There's nothing wrong with that. John the Baptist proved it. The guy who had the most evidence still doubted. But I'm telling you, as a matter of absolute motherfucking fact, absolute, as sure as the sun rises in the east, this is the shit that will change your life forever. Forever. To have the courage to become that which your soul is calling you to become. Everything changes from there. So, that being said, the guy with the empty bookcase, the total fucking moron in your life, is saying, have a happy evening, and it's been a pleasure, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. Thanks. Skol.